Hey everybody, welcome to an all-new episode of All Wing, whatever we're going to call this thing. It does not have a name. Hi, welcome to our third of what will hopefully be four streams. Kind of just digging through the Confederation Handbook, essentially the manual to the movie. I'm just doing a little bit of the old soft shoe here while we see if anybody shows up in chat and wants to let me know how the audio is, because I have no idea how audio works, and I never have and I never will. So let me know if it sounds okay, and we'll start talking Wing Commander. As always, I will be answering questions or comments or whatever anybody wants to engage with, either in the YouTube chat or on the CIC Discord. Everybody should be in the CIC Discord. It's nice and chill. Shingo says, I love that we get a new Loaf logo with each stream, and that is true. I realized like 2 seconds before I started that I hadn't done one this time, so I ran to a website that generates fonts and got you Loaf exclamation point. But I'm not what we're here to talk about. We are here to talk about the Confederation Handbook, once again represented here in PDF form thanks to Richard Pickles and his fantastic Origin Archive. I encourage anybody to go download a copy. Just fine to break the law when it gives you a copy of the Confederation Handbook. Daniel Higgins asks, is it easier for you if you chat in Discord? No, it's actually, since the last time I was doing this regularly, it seemed to have greatly improved OBS, so I get a nice chat right here on my side of my screen. I also got one of those really wide monitors at some point in the last 3 years, so I can see everything at once, kind of. Except, I can't see it all very well, so I still have to do this. So, welcome everybody. I hope you all have had a good week. I can't say I had a good week. It was pretty much a mess here. I was actually going to stream over the weekend, and life got in the way. My poor dad had a heart attack working outside at home, and it was really scary there for a minute. But he's fine. I wouldn't be telling this story with this much happiness if it was not fine, but he's fine. He's out of the hospital already, doing really, really well. We just went over there and saw him yesterday. We watched Asteroid City with my parents and hung out. Everything's good, but quite a week to go through. And now I'm here to talk about Wing Commander again. All right, so as we have, actually I've got a couple of cool things I saw earlier today I wanted to share. This is just an image I happened to see someone post on Twitter, this is just an image I happened to see on X, the Everything Act, that an artist posted earlier, and I thought it was fantastic, and I wanted to share it here because it's incredibly thematically connected to what we're doing. So here's a fellow named Alpha, who has done his own paint over of the rapier from the Wing Commander movie, and it's really, really cool. I would get that printed on a wall or whatever people print things on now. In fact, I think we can see if we go through the handbook just a little bit, we can see what inspired that guy. So can see it's a version of that image. Pretty cool. I love the sense of it. It's kind of like World War II comic book. It would fit right in like a modern Star Wars comic. Anyway, I thought that was so cool. I would have shared it with everybody. And I also have, came in the mail the other day, it's the Odyssey. This is the same edition of the Odyssey that we talked about this in general last week, I think, but this is the same edition of the Odyssey that, it's up here somewhere. There, oh, okay, so it's covered up in the Pix book. Now I remember that. But it's the same edition. We figured out what this is, the translation and a specific edition. It's a, it's from the first, I think this is a 1922. It seems like anything you get from like 1890 to 1926 or so is the same layout if you want to match Blair's book exactly. And maybe at some point we should read the first six books of the Odyssey and see what they actually knew before the movie started. Let's see if I can find the exact movie page. Ah, there we go. This is the page that is open. We get the that's the spread we get in the movie when we first see Blair. We talked a bunch about the beginning of the movie in just a few minutes. She says, I still want to know what we're supposed to call tweets. I saw somebody say Zeets, but I don't think that's official. I saw that too. It was not official, and the way you knew it wasn't real was that they'd thought to have a fact. I'm sure this will all go away in a few days. Didn't they already do this once where they like changed the icon to dog poop for a day and everybody laughed at that? It's all stupid. It's all very stupid. Yeah. Jump up to our section of the handbook. If you're interested in the first two sections of the handbook, check out the 4 or 5 hours of this we've already done. Whoever thought it would take this long to read this book? I did not. But we have some cool stuff for you planned tonight. Once I get into the groove, here's our index for tonight. We're going to look at Pegasus Naval Base, the big asteroid base from the start of the movie. We're going to look at the command officer profiles. Look at that picture. That says we've created a four-part headshot out of Wing Commander movie actors. I never noticed that before. That is ridiculous. All right. We're going to be talking about the Skiffer missile. Always a big topic among Wing Commander fans who want to complain about the movie. And then we're going to look at the Iason. Our first Iason? Iason? We're going to hear it pronounced in the movie, which I guess trumps reality. So we've got a special clip cut from the movie. Jason says, why is this chat not sending? The world wonders. Maybe I'm intentionally slowing down your, you know, that like thing you can do where it's slowly, because I don't want anyone taking away from my star power in this thing. No, if I had my way, I would make myself like this big. Oh, you can't see that because that's not how OBS works. Okay. These documents are all secret classified, so this is the ones next to top secret. How is Blair accessing these? Why is he accessing them? We don't know. This setup doesn't quite explain why he's like breaking into Admiral Tallwyn's email. But maybe it also explains why Admiral Tallwyn ends up not liking him so much. Hey, the Gante is here. How are you doing? No sound issues. Jason says it's a little low. Let me know if you're... Thanks, Chris. how is that? Let me know if that fixed the low audio problem. If not, I'll figure something else out. The other thing I wanted to share, also coming to us courtesy of X the Everything app, and this is one of the things I'm really going to miss when X the Everything app is gone. No, I don't have the Yeti plugged in. That's why the headset mic should do something. Theoretically. So, some fellow named Supcat on Twitter sent me this, which is a t-shirt for people who enjoy the font Stop. Stop is this 80s font that inspired the famous Wing Commander font. And it's one of those things where I just followed somebody on X the Everything app because they had really interesting content. They were always posting these weird Japanese cars and things, and then it turned out they loved fonts, and I replied to something they said about Stop, and then they made me a t-shirt, so that's really cool. A little bit quiet, they're saying. Let me see. I'm maxed out here on levels. I wonder if this matters. Is that any better? All right. I got it right in the first time. All right. Let's look at the article about Pegasus Naval Base. Unless anybody else has anything they want to talk about, feel free to interrupt, because I'm just going to ramble otherwise. And I am watching chat. All right. Pegasus Naval Base. Now, as you may have become accustomed to in this second half of this book, it's a lot of text and not too much artwork, because we're in the black and white part of the manual. So why even bother looking nice? But this article is cool. Dave asks if I got my 4K movie. It actually just, I heard the ALEXA ping that it had been delivered just before I started. So we've got War of the Worlds in 4K to watch later. Actually, I got that because I know my dad will want to watch it. I'm going to bring it over there and we will try to entertain him since he can't have fun drinking or doing whatever old people generally do. Pegasus Naval Base is the big asteroid base at the start of the Wing Commander movie, and I have a little slideshow. Slideshows are back. I have a slideshow showing some of its inspirations in the Wing Commander series, because if there's one thing Wing Commander does really, really well, and better than Star Wars, I would argue, is space stations in asteroids. So let's take a look at a couple of others in Wing Commander history. There's Ayers Rock in the Ayers system. How did the Ayers system come about? Because obviously it's named after the actual Ayers Rock, and but the system is just called Ayers. Who knows what the backstory there is? But that's Ayers Rock, the Mandarin base in Wing Commander 2 Special Operations 2 that you eventually take a mace to. Or it blows up on its own, just like the Simpsons meme. If you happen to fail that mission but do the second chance, it blows up on its own. All right, let's see if the slideshow actually works. Yes! The Privateer 2 mining base / pirate base. One of the all-time most iconic Wing Commander bases. This image was included in Origin FX. It's pasted everywhere. It's a beautiful model, and it's just the quintessential asteroid base. Dave says, I prefer the asteroid from Wing Commander 3. Delius is better. Well, I've got good news for you. I didn't forget that one. The one thing I would point out about this, which I discovered just a couple of months ago, if you take the Privateer Manual, the Privateer Manual has this shot of a galaxy landing somewhere. It looks like some kind of futuristic city. It's not one of the landouts from the game. It's actually the asteroid base towers being reused to make it look like skyscrapers in the background of a landing pad, created only for that image. So if next time you look at the Privateer Manual, you won't be able to not see it. And then Wing Commander 3 is the absolute king of sticking things in asteroids. We have the Delius asteroid base from the Losing series of Delius. This is a great one because so much work went into this. There's a fly-through hangar. There's a secret corridor you can fly through to get into the center of the base and see the, I don't know if it's supposed to be, it's something. It's a, like a big power generator or something. And it only appears in a pair of missions in the Losing series that most people never even see. And then we also, Wing Commander 3 also has the Confed Theta Type 2 Depot, where the T-bombs were kept and where you reload for the final mission. And last but not least, for our little prototype slideshow that taught me how to do it again, the however you say it, is the Kilrathi Asteroid Fighter from Wing Commander 3, and it is a pain in the ass. But, pain in the butt, this is... Yeah. One of the most ridiculous Wing Commander nerd things I remember specifically enjoying was when the Kilrathi Saga manual came out and they finally gave a name to this thing. Because in Wing Commander 3, it's not in the manual. It's just, there's just a little mention in one of the like Intel reports that a fighter covered in asteroids has been spotted. And there's no stats or anything. They added the stats to the Kilrathi Saga manual, and they gave it that name, ridiculous name, K-H-AJF, and, lore. Yes, Dave said he hated that fighter. Everyone hates that fighter. It can take so much damage. They're a pain. And here is Pegasus itself from, I thought it would be good to show Pegasus itself from the beginning of the movie. And I love this. This is a composite photo from a couple of frames of the movie overhead. It just reminds me of the famous, like, you read about Japanese spies in World War II literally going to Pearl Harbor and just buying postcards that showed the Navy base, the aerial photographs of the Navy base, like souvenir postcards, and helping to plan the attack that way. I just love this image of all the ships in their berth. This is Wing Commander's Pearl Harbor, thematically and literally. One of Wing Commander's various Pearl Harbors, we say, remembering action stations. And, of course, we should just have the final reminder that Pegasus Naval Base was actually constructed by Nokia, which I'm pretty sure is a defunct company now, so that one did not last so long. And can you look at this picture without hearing the Privateer 2 pad sound, which is played over it for some reason? You cannot. So let's talk about some of the lore in this article, because there's some really valuable, cool stuff here in particular. So this first line is super important to figuring out the geography of the Wing Commander movie. In previous days here, we've looked at like how we use the prophecy map for the movie. You know, they used it in the intro. We use it for the history of the Pilgrim and the Karathi Wars. They, in fact, derive the Pilgrim backstory from stuff that happened to be on the map. But in the movie itself, we get these little headers for a couple of locations. You know, we know the Sol system. We know the Tiger's Claws is in the Enyo system at the start before it starts heading back to Earth. But there's no placard that tells us where Pegasus is beyond that it is in something called the Ulysses Corridor, which is not referenced anywhere else. So this single line right here, where it says location D5 asteroid belt, asteroid D344R, Dakota system Vega sector, unlocks a whole lot of like geographic understanding for Wing Commander. Suddenly, we can place all the events of the movie on the universe map. We can figure out where the theoretical Charybdis jumps from that previous article we saw lead to. And it just feels a little bit more at home knowing that, hey, that's also the system where in a couple months the Tiger's Claw is going to bring the vaccine for Watson's disease. And by the way, that's something that wouldn't happen in real life. We now know the government, the military bringing a vaccine to help everyone. There would be riots in the street. But I digress. Dakota system. So it's in the original Vega sector map, the one that you can go all the way back to the original claw marks and find out where Pegasus is. And there's nice history here about how it was, I love when we get a little bit about the government, because you can drop that into your big document of Wing Commander civilian government facts. So it was commissioned by the Confederate Senate Security Committee to act as the primary strategic installation in the Vega sector in 2638. And then it took 6 years to build, 8 years to build. And I just love this kind of history because it means nothing, but you can go back and tell that story. So Pegasus, as of the Wing Commander movie, was commissioned 6 years earlier. Before I go to the next page and talk, though, I want to point out unit designations, which are, you know, just somebody making up a lot of, what does that mean to anybody? But the one that here that's especially important to me is, you know, we see fleet designations all the time in the novels and things, 4th Fleet, 14th Fleet, and 14th Fleet in Wing Commander 2. We hear about, you know, we just assume Marines work like they do in real life. But here's the first time we've really kind of addressed the idea that the Space Force is a separate branch of the military. And obviously it is, it has different ranks, there's all sorts of confusion about that. But here we have, it's the 32nd Space Force. So this is the same way you would have like the 8th Air Force in World War II. We have different Space Forces in Wing Commander, and they planetary bases, that's part of the structure. So I like the world building that happens in the background. Chris Reed says Nokia bounced back. Well, that's good to know. Daniel says Nokia is still around. They just mainly make radios for cell carriers. Though eventually they make asteroid bases in the Vega sector. They'll get there eventually. And Dave says there's a cameo in Star Trek 2009. So there must have been like a decade of just sponsoring stuff in Hollywood to get in there. Yeah, you say they probably used some production people names? Yes, I am sure that almost all of these are Tuckerizations. Admiral William Wilson is, of course, the character from the movie, but like you can see here, Commodore Tuesday Frase, that must be Tuesday Frase, the origin artist who worked on the movie. So I don't know Jacob Yabara, but it sure sounds like somebody you would meet in Austin. But the next page, we have the history of Pegasus Naval Station. And this is something that I love when you get to do this kind of tertiary world building. You know, the Wing Commander movie treats the attack on Pegasus Station like this crazy, unique thing. And then we have this book that's like, oh, it's been attacked twice before. Karathi routinely throw fleets at it and lose. So it's not that they've discovered Pegasus in the movie. They're just finally attacking in a way that worked. But Pegasus was attacked in 48 and 52. Oh, I should mention the timeline I've been working on. I went ahead and have all this in it already. I split it up by eras, so there's like 6 different tabs at the bottom. But and again, I encourage anybody to help me out. I'm going to get back to it after this. We're working on Victory Streak next. We should do a Victory Streak stream. Victory Streak stream. It would be cool to read through Victory Streak. There's a lot of stuff to talk about there. Giorgio says Pegasus was a legendary horse which could fly in Greek mythology. Yes, and as with a lot of stuff in the Wing Commander movie, there's just kind of weird like callbacks to Greek mythology. You know, in addition, you know, you got Charybdis and Scylla and Charybdis with Pegasus. We've got the Ulysses Corridor. A lot of, you know, the Iason, Captain Androphilos. There's all sorts of like classical age of, you know, Greek exploration in the DNA of the Wing Commander movie, which is nice because so many times sci-fi universes are just, here's World War II in space. It has bad Germans and bad Japanese space equivalents, and then the good guys are all great. So it's nice seeing bits and pieces of other cultures. Especially really cool cultures. And, you know, I don't know if you can even really make it out so well in this picture, but the Pegasus, you can see the Pegasus logo that they wear on the patches in that intro scene is an actual Pegasus. You know what? Let me break from my plans and see if I can find that image on the internet, just because I would like to share it. Luckily, I did an article on Wing Commander. Ah, here we go. Of course, how do I share this is the next question. Let me do this the stupid way. Oh, wait, you know what? I can just, I bet I still have something that will share my Chrome. Nope. See, if I were good at this, I could do patter throughout this change in plan. I actually have one of these patches, too, but, you can see behind me, everything is a mess. There we go. That is what the Pegasus patch in the background of the book that we're looking at looks like. Pulled it off flawlessly. And you can see it's the watermark in the back of the handbook. Unfortunately, it's not in color, so I can't just extract the image and have a cool Pegasus picture. But that's on all the uniforms, it's on the little helmets, it's on the patches of the characters who are in that opening Pegasus scene. Let's see, Giorgio says, was Commander Gerald's character a nod to the U-boat captain in Das Boot? Pretty much everything in the Wing Commander movie is a nod to Das Boot, so absolutely. Literally hiring the guy who did an amazing job playing the captain in Das Boot to play the captain of the space submarine for this is that's just the most Chris Roberts process imaginable. So yes, absolutely. He was thinking about Das Boot throughout this, and yeah, totally. But I wanted to try something special, which I thought of just like 20 minutes before we started, so this may go terribly wrong, but I wanted to talk about why Pegasus is so important to this book. What a little bit that was cut from the movie, and it's kind of an important bit that was cut from the movie. So You are all familiar with the final version of the Wing Commander movie. It opens with this absolutely brilliant, wonderful, you know, if that was the entire movie, it would be the perfect film. You know, credit sequence where we see, like, the history of the Confederation and the Karathi kind of played in the background over the map, and then we eventually kind of transition into the asteroid field, and our camera follows over, and we reveal it's not actually an asteroid, it's Pegasus, and we see that overhead shot of the ships in their berth, and then we zoom into the window. We do a zoom in, and we do a match cut into the window where it's the characters are running around. They've detected the Kilrathi attack, and that's a wonderful intro. I love that, all of that. It's really well done. I think of it especially because I remember in the lead up to the movie, one of the things that they were smart enough to do, which not everybody was doing in 1998-99, was bring in the Ain't It Cool News guys to Digital Anvil to show them specifically that scene, which was one of the first ones that was CGI complete. And they went out and raved about it, and I thought that was the coolest thing. I wanted to see the intro of the Wing Commander movie. That's how you build hype today. You go to influencers and you get them to talk about your movie or your dress or your whatever is happening. But the movie was not supposed to open that way. The credit sequence was something that they did much, much later. It was not something they planned when the movie was first shot. It was something Chris spent months experimenting with trying to get it right. They even did like a Star Wars style text at one point that had Freddie Prinze Jr. reading an intro. They did a bunch of different attempts to start the movie right. And the reason they had to do that was because there was a longer intro that Chris really, really wanted. The idea was to open, not just in the asteroid field, the movie was supposed to open on like an idyllic beach. It was supposed to actually look like Pearl Harbor. You were supposed to see sailors in their little white sailor hats and ladies in bikinis playing on the beach. They're throwing space frisbees. And then we pan up and we see that this is actually a space station. It's an artificial beach that's giving this like 1940s World War II sense, but it's in a space station. And these soldiers are on, the sailors are on leave. They're running around playing, having fun. They have no idea that Kilrathi are coming, and then the attack starts. And Chris was so passionate about that scene. He desperately wanted to do it. But when, you know, they boarded it, they planned for it. When they actually got to shooting the movie, it was totally out of, you know, there was no budget for it. But he kept up with the idea that if we do a good enough job on the rest of the movie, we can go back and add this. And he fought and fought and fought and unfortunately lost for this idea of having this opening scene that he thought was particularly spectacular that would really grab viewers. Because he understood that you need to grab people at the very start of a movie rather than just do cool stuff later. Unfortunately, it never happened. But we've got the storyboards. I thought we would go through them and see kind of what could have been. Yes, too much money for the open, Dave asked. Yeah. But here we can see. Let's get a look at what it would have been. So we open with the interior asteroid worldlet city beach. And this is our, this is where the titles would go. It would say Wing Commander, directed by whoever. The camera pans over the water to the beach itself, hold on sea and sand, and then bare feet running through the frame along the shore. No Quentin Tarantino joke here. Group of off-duty sailors run along the shore. By a park bench, a woman rums oil onto her sailor's boyfriend back. A second group of sailors and their girlfriends, all dressed in shorts and tops with tropical designs, play a game of ultimate frisbee further up the beach. A tall sailor throws long, and we follow his teammate as he makes a high jump to catch the frisbee. And then a pan up to reveal the skyline of a 27th century city, nestled against the far wall of this hollowed-out island in space. Higher up, huge, fusion-powered sun lamp, the source of our artificial sunlight, are embedded in rough-hewn granite roof, surrounded by an enormous portal.
Superimpose. Ulysses Sector Fleet Headquarters, Terran Confederation Asteroid World Pegasus, March 15th, Earth Year 2654, 0900 hours Zulu time. Resume beach. The teammate falls back to Earth, clutching the frisbee triumphantly. But the tall sailor isn't watching. He continues to gaze upward at something overhead. His point of view through giant portal. A strange constellation of luminous dots has now appeared in the black oval. Not stars, something else. Resume beach. Air raid sirens begin to wail from the towers of the city. The sailor boyfriend, alarmed, jumps up, grabbing his girlfriend. She, too, looks up through the portal. We follow her gaze. Checking out the portal again. And then the missiles strike the portal, and a huge explosion briefly blinds us, washing over the reinforced plexiglass and blocking our view of the stars. Shockwaves. Several sailors lose their footing as the ground shakes violently. Everyone seems frozen, looking up, and for a moment, it seems as the portal survived the impact, but... Sailor boyfriend and girl looking up at portal. Point of view, sailor boyfriend portal, no change, then... Close on portal. Small spider line cracks start spreading over to the surface of the portal. They multiply with frightening speed, and then... The plexiglass shatters outwards. Shock continued, sucking atmosphere from the worldlet. Resume beach. Everything is being sucked upward. The sailor boyfriend, hanging onto the park bench, is trying to desperately hold onto his girlfriend. End of camera move. Back to first person view. But his grip slips, and she too is sucked upward. Camera moves faster than the girl. Flying rock mauls girl for transition. Camera continues moving up. Girl continues being sucked upwards. Camera continues moving up. Debris flip through the upper frame. Pushing out of portal. At a part of the asteroid world explosions, the ground zooms more. And here is where the attack starts in the regular movie, where we start seeing the ships dive bombing the Pegasus itself. That was the original intro for the movie. Would it have saved the film? I don't know. Would it have been pretty cool? Yeah, I would have loved to see it. Chris was certainly super, super passionate about it, and always trust the creators for stuff like this. So, yeah, I realized I had those scanned just before the show, and I was like, I could cut them out really quick and do like a little like 1950s style cartoon. And there we are. That was it. I think that's everything we have to say about Pegasus itself. There's some great lore in here. One I love is when we come up with just normal bureaucratic backgrounds, like naval personnel rotated between 2 years on Pegasus and 2 years at either Icarus Base in the Pedro system or Titan Base in the Sol system. Other services are rotated as directed by their respective command. Just seems like normal military stuff. But what is Icarus Base in the Pedro system? That's not mentioned anywhere else. You've built a little part of the universe there. Just in passing. AD says, yeah, they didn't have the budget for this opening. Chris was pushing for money to film it in reshoots that would have been the same time as the Karathi reshoots, but the studio didn't bite. And that's the difference between a game studio like Origin that doesn't want to give Chris Roberts unlimited money, but will if he's doing a good job, that will clearly make that money back. A studio does not care. If they said no money, movie studio does not care. If they have given you $10 million to make a movie and you come asking for the $11 million after the movie's been shot, they're not going to do it. And unfortunately, that is a lesson they learned. So, what is next? Well, here's one we hinted at the other day, and I'm sure you can all see what's wrong with this page as soon as I show it to you. They did not have a nice headshot of Ken Bones in his uniform. There's plenty of media of him in the Pilgrim outfit that is not used in the movie and obviously could not be in here in the first place. So we have a still of him firing his gun at the camera. He's trying to destroy the Navcom AI from the movie itself. Maybe it should have been a giveaway, Admiral Tallwin, when you were looking through your working on your personnel reviews. And just like the pilot personnel reviews, I love this world building. I love this setup. This is Admiral Tallwin's file of the command level, commander and higher level personnel bios. And again, this is in accordance with the procedures of Section D-147, Paragraph G of the Security Act of 2649. Just good stuff. This one in particular, Admiral Wilson, Ken Bones in the movie, who was originally the traitor, and then all of that was cut, so you only see him at the station at the beginning. I bet if we go back through these streams, I've said that like 7 times already. But that's who Admiral Wilson is. This does a good job of giving him the slightest implied backstory as to why he turns traitor. And that is that we have here his marital status, his wife Arette, which is the French word for stop, I think. she died 3 years before the movie, which is 2654. So she died either in November 2651 or on January 11th, 2651. It's not quite clear how the handbook is doing months. But it does these with 1 or 2 digits that I think might be intended to be months rather than days. His wife, and then we have another mention in here. One of Tallwin's notes is, "Note, don't mention Mrs. Wilson unless he does so first, puts him in a bad mood." So there's something about his wife's death that he blames on the Confederation. He doesn't want to talk about. It's broken his mind and set him to ally with the Pilgrims. Who knows? But they do some world building right there that is nice. The one I like to point out that's almost certainly a weird error is that his birth date is 2498.134, which is April 2498, and that's about 100 years off. Because that would make him 156 in the Wing Commander movie, which is possible with the with some of the movie's early ideas about, I say ideas about, but I mean from some of the stuff the movie stole from the Forever War, where the soldiers are doomed to be fighting on a different time than people on Earth. But I'm sure they meant 2598, and this is one of those things that when you do a Wing Commander timeline, it shows up in the weirdest place that Admiral Wilson was born in the 25th century instead of the 27th or 26th or 27th century. But he doesn't look bad for a guy that old. Yeah, characters do seem to age. People do seem to live longer in Wing Commander, which not new. That's not something that happens in present day. But we do have some septuagenarian admirals who are still fighting at some point. And just cool lore in here. The persistent rumors of a drinking problem. Admiral Tallwin has looked into them, and they're nonsense. Just interesting stuff, the kind of things you would think would be in this personal log. And the recommendations for them. I don't think he has the fire for fleet command. If he asks for retirement at 35, I'll grant it. If he decides to stay on until he gets his 40, that's all right as well. However, I don't see him getting any further promotions. I could easily see him staying in charge of Pegasus for the duration and beyond. John Adams says, maybe if he had the Carathian bikinis, they could have gotten approval to do both at the same time. That's quite possible. Years ago, Origin was doing was pitching a privateer television show. This was in 94, 95. After Wing Commander 3 was a huge hit, they were trying to turn it into a bigger franchise. You know, they eventually got the Academy show and a couple of other cross-media things. But one of the big, brilliant, ballsy proposals that Chris was behind was a Privateer 2 television show. Basically, they would do Privateer 2, not The Darkening, but a Privateer basically set parallel to Wing Commander 4. They even had this idea that it would cross over with Wing Commander 4, and they would get Admiral Tallwin in, you know, they would get Malcolm McDowell in the game briefly, or in the show briefly. And the idea was there would be Privateer 2 that would introduce 2 main characters, one of whom would go off and have a season of TV episodes, and the other one would have the adventure in the game, and then they would do Privateer 3 a year later, where you would have the conclusion to the adventures, where the characters team up again and they have one final adventure that solves whatever the big mystery of the season was, you know, defeating a Karathi warlord or something.
And the Bible was pitched by Aaron. Bible was put together by Aaron Alston. We've got it on the CIC if you want to read it. It's pretty cool. It's one of those things that sounds amazing on paper. Having worked in the game industry for a minute, I can tell you the idea of having two Chris Roberts games that absolutely had to ship on the specific days that a TV show aired its premiere and its finale in the 90s would have been a true logistical nightmare. The reason I brought it up was because I got to talk to Aaron Alston about it at a convention years ago, and he said, yeah, it was a really exciting project, but he was glad it didn't happen. You know, they sent the Bible off to the studio in LA that was interested, and it came back as, like, they could go to the planet of the Amazon bikini women. It's like that was the big exciting pitch that they came back with. So he was glad they didn't trash it up to make it possible. And but who knows? What is the world like where we got those games and that show? Sebastian said the closest we got to a live-action TV show was maybe Space Above and Beyond. Absolutely. Space Above and Beyond is as Wing Commander. Heavily influenced and just a great show with a great Wing Commander style to it. If you haven't watched Space Above and Beyond, absolutely do it. ODVS, who does the incredible Wing Commander 3 and 4 up-reses. I think he does every HD up-res in the world now. He was our secret for a while, but the world found him. He's up-resed all the Saab episodes. They look great. I think they're on YouTube because Fox doesn't care. Absolutely check it out. It's not just Wing Commander in concept. It's Wing Commander in mood. And we probably couldn't have done better than that for a Wing Commander show, honestly. It's a beautiful show. It's they spent so much time building the world of the show, how the Navy stuff works, and the graphics, the background of Space Boom Beyond is so good. Jim Martin got his start there. He would go on to define the Defiant and all sorts of Star Citizen ships that I'm sure you remember. He did my tattoo, actually. My other tattoo, right? He did the tattoo for Starship Troopers, which is a tattoo that I have. In fact, we're going to be talking about my other tattoo in a minute, so this is a really, you're going to get a lot of Ben skin this episode. So, Admiral Wilson, he's not going to be promoted, but they're happy with him in his current job. Yeah. Now we have Commodore Richard Beauregard. People who have seen the movie know who that is. People who have obsessively seen the movie who know who that is. People who have just seen the movie in passing probably don't. It's Admiral Tallwyn's aide in the who's standing next to him in the couple of scenes on the Concordia. Basically the guy Tallwyn plays off of to explain what's going on. He has kind of like a Scottish accent, and he's kind of distinct. But you kind of distinct when you see him. But there's very little of a character in the movie. He's just there. And here's his very detailed bio, what is the part here I wanted to point out? They have this whole backstory about how he missed the Pilgrim War, so he feels like he doesn't have the experience that other people of his rank do, but Tallwyn really appreciates him, and he's bad at playing cards, just all sorts of little details like this. Peter Telef takes this for Pilgrim Stars and Pilgrim Truth and does this whole arc about how he's an alcoholic who hates Earth and he has to learn to appreciate why the war is being fought. And that all comes literally from the details here. Fancies himself a ladies' man. He does not sufficiently appreciate the importance of Confed and of terror itself as a concept. He sees the present war merely as an us versus them survival struggle, without regard to its long-term ramification to our race and culture. So Tallwyn's already kind of sounding like a Nazi in his notes. No, we got the bikini pictures. They were they were the cartoon earlier. So what was I talking about? Also, you probably most remember him from the international trailer for Wing Commander, the first one that we ever saw, the one that we at WCNews.com managed to take Ultima Online offline for a day because we put it on Origin's server without asking. You hear him talking to Tallwyn a bit more in that, and I guess that's why people know him. Tallwyn's advice is that he
I'd like to boost Richard to rank and give him a fleet, or perhaps a whole sector, but not until I can find somebody who can replace him at his current post. But again, this is something we often don't see in science fiction world building. So many admirals and commanders and generals in sci-fi are just a guy in an office who gives orders, when the reality is you have a staff of adjuncts and advisors and tactical groups, and Admiral Tolman would be overseeing hundreds of people who are feeding him data and let him make his decisions. And you never see, like, the Badmiral in Star Trek, like, with their adjunct and talking to their staff about what they should do. It's always, this guy got so powerful and now he can do whatever he wants. Yeah, he sounds like a Templar bomb to Earth would not have bothered him. I guess the idea is he does not care about Earth, he just cares about the war, and that somehow becomes a long-running story in those Pilgrim novels. And here, shameless plug here, but if you're interested in the Templar bomb, check out a thread I did on X the Everything app a couple days. See, they do have everything ago. Or it's been turned into an article in the CIC where we collected pretty much every reference to the Templar bomb and told the story of its development and use and impact, basically intending to have it be parallel to the story of Robert Oppenheimer, because there's a big Oppenheimer movie right now. And my hope was that people would read that and take away, hey, it's kind of interesting that the Wing Commander universe pays a little bit more attention to the various victims of the bomb testing and use than the movie. But no one has picked up on that. Remember all the stuff about the Paxons in Wing Commander 3 with Vagabond, and they were, millions were killed in testing the bomb? You don't get anything like that in the Nolan movie. No mention of the Downwinders or their reaction to Hiroshima or anything. So it's interesting parallel. And I will say that's intentional, because although Dr. Severin in Wing Commander 3 is a character who appears so briefly that his actor isn't even credited. He just shows up for Vagabond to punch him and end that little arc. That whole story was written by a pair of writers from New Mexico, specifically Albuquerque, New Mexico, or not Albuquerque, Santa Fe, no, Albuquerque, yeah, Albuquerque, New Mexico, where the impact of the Trinity test is, and the history of the Trinity test is particularly known. So stuff like having Paladin as, General Groves, and the impact of the test on civilians and stuff, is all comes out of that little pocket of expertise, because it happened to be someone from that area. I don't know. Dale Higgins said he saw Oppenheimer and that it was good. I am looking forward to seeing it. Going back to my dad's heart attack, there's a seg. 2 weeks ago, we were over there, and he asked me, as any dad would, because it is the daddiest possible movie you can imagine. That didn't sound right. The daddest possible movie you can imagine. He said, do you want to go see Oppenheimer when it comes out? And I said, sure. Do you want to go see Barbie? And he, like, scoffed, like, no. And then he had a heart attack, and we went over there, and he was like, so do you want to go see Barbie? So, it changes you, man. Let's see. Next page. We've looked at Richard Bellegarde enough. I believe, and I don't know for sure, I think he's in some... The actor has gone on to be more successful, so I don't know actors so well. But I feel like I looked him up at some point and said, oh, wow, he's that guy. And, as asked about earlier, here is Commander Gerald, Admiral Gerald, if you know weird errors in the Wing Commander movies on-screen displays. If you look at Tolman's message, the various like background screens, one of them says it's Admiral Gerald of the Tiger's Claw as the commander. He's not the commander, and he's not Admiral, but that's the same screens that spell Tolman wrong at the start of the movie. So here we learn all about Commander Gerald, and again, this all kind of previews how he acts in the movie, but it also talks about what a good commander he is, because the one thing we always forget when we have a jerk commander or an evil admiral or anything is they got there for a reason. They must be good at something. So we do talk about how he has an affinity for the care of pilots. He knows how the Tiger's Claw's wing saw a 23% jump in efficiency during his first year as XO and continues to climb. And something they do in Wing Commander 2 that I loved, you hate Admiral Tolman, the player hates Admiral Tolman, Captain Blair hates Admiral Tolman, But whenever he goes and tries to bitch about him to, you know, even his oldest friends like Angel or somebody like Sparks, they always stick up for the Admiral. He's their leader. He's led them through countless death-defying adventures. They won't just agree with you because you happen to have a personal conflict with him. And that's the kind of nuance I love in this stuff. I like a big pulpy universe that has vague rules, and then I love a little bit of nuance where you don't expect it. It's like when you're having a chocolate ice cream and it's got like these little slivers of peanut butter, and then you find one of the bits of peanut butter and you're like, I'm good at analogies. I'm really just thinking about some ice cream I had yesterday. Great World has spent almost all of his career to data board characters in one capacity or another. Just gives you a background for him rather than he's just a space racist. And they call that out here. Reported to be inflexible and a bit prejudiced. Like far too many of our officers who came aboard since the last war, Gerald is all too eager to blame the Pilgrims for everything from crop blight on Brack to the latest advance in Karathi fighter tech. And that is a Jay Allen Brack reference right there. Wing Commander is full of them. Everyone in the world knows Jay Allen Brack as the now sadly disgraced president of Blizzard. He was the guy who got put in after the previous president quit, and he kind of got all the blame for what happened there with the culture stuff. But he's a good guy. He has been so kind to us over the years with Wing Commander stuff. He's a big Wing Commander fan. He started out in QA, got into more active development through Wing Commander, and he gets referenced throughout. There's a TCS Brack in the Wing Commander Prophecy Manual. They loved him on the team, and they stuck his name all over the place. Yeah, Georgia says, yeah, Sparks certainly supports Tallwood. She even reprimands Blair at one point for that. Yeah, because there's like three or four scenes in Wing Commander 2 where Blair goes to either Angel or Sparks, and he's like, yeah, Admiral Tallwood's sure a jackass. And they're like, we don't think that, but we like you. And that's how human relationships work. My wife and I can, one of us can like somebody and the other can dislike them, and neither one of them is the universal answer on that person. One bad experience can turn you into blah, blah, etc. You know what I'm saying. I don't know what I'm saying, but you might. I realize now I haven't even been looking at Discord. But no one's saying anything. Scout says he's bummed he forgot his chocolates at his apartment. He had brought them but left them in the car in 90-degree weather, so now it's even worse. So, Scout's not having a good day. By the way, how proud are we all of Scout? The time has passed so insanely quickly, the last 5 years or so. I remember when he showed up on Discord, he was just this teenager, and we were like, what is a kid doing here? We're all weird, unpleasant adults who have lived for far too long, and there's some kid who likes Wing Commander. And I just am genuinely proud of him going through college and becoming like a scientist or something. It's cool. It's cool to watch people become better than they were. I don't know. We're proud of you, Scout. I don't think you're watching this because you're at work doing science, but we're glad you joined our community. Dave says, I imagine a breakfast death would change your father's priorities. Yeah, I think that happens with everybody. But it was funny to see him suddenly wanting to do Barbenheimer instead of just Oppenheimer. Let's see. What else are we looking at here with Commander Gerald? Daughter Sandy. That is not a reference to Chris Roberts' wife, Sandy. He did not know her at that time. It's just a coincidence. Spelled differently, too. And here, his birth dates all make sense. I still can't tell if these are supposed to be months or years. Like, is 33.06 the month he graduated the academy, or did he graduate on January 6th? And same for promotion. I could see either way. And, just random facts about Commander Gerald. He's a competitive marksman. He likes camping. He seems like the kind of guy who likes camping. But that is Gerald, who, and of course we noted earlier, he's here because of Das Boot. And here we have Captain Sansky, the captain of the Tiger Claw, who again in the original movie is a traitor. In the final film, there's a point where he's injured and he falls down, and they just cut him from the rest of the movie so you don't see him again. It just implied that he died in the background. But the original idea was that he was the one betraying the Tiger's Claw, and he was communicating with Admiral Wilson
as part of a global conspiracy of similar-looking bald guys. He's of course for best known as now I can't remember the name, the detective, somebody will have to tell me because that my brain has stopped right here. It should be a very obvious thing, but he is the famous literary detective in many, many masterpiece theater adaptations of things. And there is a bit here. Oh, I love his military. I love when you get the military backstory for a character because it gives you all these battles you didn't know anything about. I've seen him bring ships back from situations I'd have thought were hopeless. He earned himself a senatorial star during the Epsilon Initiative. That's one of the campaigns in the 40s in the movie lore, while commanding the Halsey. Let's see. Oh, wait, let me go back to Gerald for a second. There is one of these where Tallman references the captain of the Tiger's Claw, who is named Dwight, and they say they would be happy to bring so-and-so, I think it's Gerald, they bring him over to replace Dwight if he retired. And just the nuance that the Concordia in the movie has a captain that's not Admiral Tallman is, again, really good sci-fi militaria, because normally when you have an admiral on a ship, they're in command and they're doing everything. But here we have a whole structure of command where there's a captain of the Concordia who does the day-to-day stuff that we don't ever even see in the movie. Sebastian says, you think he might have been a man, or is there any reference to that? He's a pilgrim, which is kind of the same concept in the sense of the movie. Only one of them is explicitly a pilgrim, but I think you do end up getting the implication that both Sansky and Wilson are pilgrims, and that's why they hate Confed. It's not explained much more in the movie, but we do see, and this is actually in the version of the movie that was released, there's a shot of Captain Sansky in his office looking at like a holograph, or not holograph, but like a digital photo in a frame, and it's a photo of him and Wilson together. So one of them is a pilgrim and the other one is connected to them is basically the idea. And the pilgrims specifically are trying, there's a radical group of pilgrims that are trying to upset the war, let the Karathi win. And you know, that's exactly the same idea as the Mandarins. It's a group of humans who hate the Confederation so much that they would rather the Karathi win. The Mandarins had that kind of extra level where it was like, they want the Karathi to win so they can change them from inside, which is, of course, a ridiculous plan. The Pilgrims just hate humanity and want to punish them for what they did in the war. Poirot, yes, thank you, George. Poirot is the famous detective. Columbo? No, Leah, not Columbo. Hi, Dr. Jeffrey Wadley. Good to see you. We're just talking Wing Commander book here. Georgios says, Tallman commands a battle group, I think, so someone needs to run the ship. Exactly. And it's not that in Wing Commander 2. In Wing Commander 2, he makes reference to commanding the Tiger's Claw, or commanding the Concordia. But here they actually thought it out. AD says, there's also a shot in the theatrical cut of Sansky holding a pilgrim cross on the bridge. Blink and you'll miss it. There you go. Here's the reference to Dwight. If I ever need a replacement for Dwight, I wouldn't mind seeing Sansky at the helm of Concordia. So, Tallman likes him enough that he would bring him to command the Concordia. Does that, if Jason is still here, he can tell us, does that happen in real life? Can you go from being a battleship commander to a carrier commander and vice versa? I don't know. My thought was that anybody commanding a carrier had to come up from being a pilot. But maybe we don't see that in Wing Commander. And maybe it can work the other way. Maybe you can go up from being a pilot to commanding a carrier and then go and command whatever you want. The one I want to point out here that is an error solely in the context of the movie. First of all, friends call him Ski. Parentheses dislikes his given name. Okay. That's not something that's ever referenced anywhere in anything else, but you can call him Ski. The weird thing is that he's Captain Lawrence Sansky here. Maybe he dislikes what Admiral Tallman keeps calling him, because that's not his name anywhere else. He's Jay Sansky in all the other media. So, I don't know how they hit on Lawrence, but then they complained about it themselves, so there you go.
Giorgio says, isn't there a Captain Thorn commanding the Tiger's Claw in the game? Yes, kind of. So the Tiger's Claw captaincy is all very, very confusing. But basically, we have Captain Sansky here in charge during the movie. He dies. He commits suicide in the novel. He dies in a battle in the movie. That he is replaced by Gerald as the acting captain of the Tiger's Claw. Then we have Talwin, who takes command of the Tiger's Claw from him for the events of Wing Commander Academy. He's Commodore Talwin, commander of the Tiger's Claw. He's in trouble for some stuff he did, presumably in Pilgrim Truth. The attempted genocide he did in Pilgrim Truth may have been what got him kicked off to be captain of the Tiger's Claw in a safe sector. But then you have the later stuff in Wing Commander 1 and Secret Missions. We have Captain Thorn, who is referenced in a bunch of the novels. Captain Thorn, I think, and Freedom Flight, I think. So you have Captain Thorn, who's mentioned as the captain of the Tiger's Claw. You see him in Freedom Flight, so in 2665, so that's 2 years later. You have a bit in the Wing Commander 3 novel where we talk about how Talwin replaced him and accused him of being a coward or something to fight a battle and then gave up on that and he came back to be captain of the Tiger's Claw. The one that kind of makes it all even more confusing is there are references in Secret Missions 1 to Halcyon being captain of the Tiger's Claw. You may remember a scene where there's a Rallari out there and he doesn't want to get close to the Tiger's Claw because he'd rather not command a slag ship. So there's also this idea, and if you look at the orders that are from Talwin on the boxes of, or from Talwin and the previous general on the boxes of the games, they're both addressed to Halcyon commanding the Tiger's Claw. So there was some point where Colonel Halcyon was the only person left who was commander of the Tiger's Claw rather than the Wing Commander. So many people have been... many contradictory things about who commands the Tiger's Claw when. And one of the things we can look at in the timeline, actually, is see... we can figure out, now that we have this timeline of every single event in 2654, who was the captain when. And from that, you'll know who the captain was in any particular Wing Commander 1 mission. I'll look at that tonight, actually. Maybe I'll put that together for the next one of these. Now, here is our next big block of fascinating lore text, the Skipper Missile. This is one of those bridge too far for continuity-obsessed Wing Commander fans at the time. This was one of those things that absolutely the first time I read the script, I said, hey... why? Well, this is something that's new in Wing Commander 3. It's not, why are they putting it 15 years earlier in Wing Commander 1? The Wing Commander 1 era. And, you know, 25 years later, it doesn't matter at all. It's a stupid thing to complain about. But they do some lifting here to make sure that the Skipper missile being the scene in the Wing Commander movie is different than the one in the game. Here it's a big... it has a giant, giant payload. We see when Angel explodes it, and it's fired from a great distance. The Skipper missile in the game is a much smaller missile that gets fired a couple of them at a time from a corvette or a destroyer. Whereas this is something bigger and more special. But we get a nice history of it. We find out the Karathi have been building it for 8 years, and they're expecting it to be deployed in the next 6 months. One of the great things that you always get with lore like this is, you know, we've talked about this, the sci-fi fans absolutely love is when you give the serious name to something. You know, Skipper Missile is the nickname. This is actually the K-459C Ultra Long Range Phased Photon Cloak Torpedo. The same way, like, the flashback is actually the, whatever, atmospheric ignition bomb. Giorgio says, is Halcyon a Space Force, right? I doubt the Navy would want someone from Space Forces running one of their ships. That's a good point. And that's also something that's a little bit contradictory in the game. In Wing Commander 1 itself, there is no concept of both a Space Force and a Navy. So they have no reaction to that. You know, there are no Navy ranks. There are no Navy characters. If you look at Commander Halcyon's door in Wing Commander 1... it actually says he's Commander Halcyon, like Navy style. And somebody caught that and said, oh, he should be a colonel during development of the game because we're using USAF style ranks rather than Navy ones. It's not until Wing Commander, it's not until Secret Missions 2 when they need an admiral to be the, when they basically need an, Secret Missions 1 or 2 when they need admirals to be the high commanders rather than generals, that they kind of have to start inventing, oh, there's Navy officers and there's Space Forces officers. And the movie takes the opposite tact. It says, we're not even going to do this, just give everybody Navy ranks. So you can see why they didn't have that distinguishing idea at the time. Skipper Missile. I've got some Skipper Missile media for you. Let me see what's in Skipper Slideshow. Here's the first time you see it in the movie. This is Angel's VDU. And I put this here. I put this here because I wanted to show the design of the Skipper Missile. If you go to the next page, we see a render of it, and it actually seems to be much further along than the other renders we see in the handbook. And there's a reason for that, which is that it was designed and locked on set. They designed this in Luxembourg. They did motion graphics of it for the fighters and the VDU screens like this. So the design for the Skipper Missile... The design for the Skipper Missile got locked really, really early, and this is that's why it matches the VDU right here. Oops, wrong way. I only have three images, and I'm still going the wrong way. Here is the missile just after it uncloaks in the movie itself, and it's a super intricate thing. If you go back and watch it, you'll see it decloaks with this cool cloak effect, and then these like shutters at the back that are going to direct its thrust spread out, and it makes like course corrections. You see plumes of jets as it changes direction. It's really detailed, although it's tiny in the film itself. And in fact, when Angel starts gunning it down, the animation is beautiful, and you can see, you know, one of her rounds punctures the side of it, and flames start shooting out, and it wildly goes in crazy directions. It's really, really well done. It's so late in the movie that nobody is paying attention by that point, but there's still so much detail and love in just that couple of seconds of sequence with the skipper getting shot down. And here is the Wing Commander 3 skipper, which is the KM-19Y skipper. You see, it's a different designation. But just for your edification, I do happen to have the Wing Commander 3 intro, if you want to compare it to this lore here. And here it is. Check it out.
Let's get down to business, shall we?
I'm ready, sir.
Confed civilian transport ship is moving through the Orsini area. She's going to need an escort, especially since intel reports that Carathi are testing a new cloaked missile. Confed has codenamed these new weapons skippers because they apparently skip in and out of cloak every few seconds to maintain contact with their target. Now, you can see them 1 second, then they're gone the next. There are a lot of civilian lives at stake here, girl.
I'll do my best, Captain.
I'm sure you will.
Oh, it's because I'm an idiot. Sorry about that, guys. All right, going back a minute or so. One of the things I love about that that cutscene is the very last shot. You can still see the Skipper Missile animation on the big table. But as Leha says, the design is different. The designation is different. It functions differently. You see it hits a fighter in that video rather than a capital ship. They're not, you know, it's not a multi-megaton explosive designed to destroy an entire ship, capital ship desperately.
But the other thing I wanted to mention was the question I get all the time about the Skipper missile is, what is the deal with Skipper missile just in Wing Commander 3? It seems like very poor game design. It's a great gameplay, you know, the great gameplay loop is what I think people on the internet learn the term gameplay loop, and they're saying that about everything right now. But it's a great gameplay loop adding the Skipper missile into Wing Commander. Wing Commander is a traditionally very difficult thing to make more interesting in terms of gameplay, because you kind of have this very perfect base level, and then introducing new parts to it, is player rejects them very easily. Skipper missile is something that comes in naturally and adds an extra challenge, but the difficulty is insane in Wing Commander 3. What game designer put one of the hardest missions as the third scene in Wing Commander 3? And the answer is, the actual designer of Wing Commander 3 put the Skipper missile sequence in Series H. Basically, to create Wing Commander 3, they had the designers come up with an outline of how the gameplay would work. We introduce this here, this here, this here, this here. You know, you will get to fly this ship here, this ship here, this ship here. And then the guys who wrote the script came in and said, okay, with this outline, I can stretch a story on top of it. And that's how the story came about. Wing Commander 4 was the opposite way, or not the opposite, but they all sat down together to figure out what would go where. Wing Commander 3, it was game design and then full motion video script. So one of the few changes that the guys, the two screenwriters and Chris Roberts, made to the designer's outline for Wing Commander 3 was to say, oh, the Skipper missile thing seems like such a cool idea. We're going to move it up from Series H to Series A. And that's how it got there. And it's why it's so out of place in terms of just thinking of like a professionally designed game, where it just suddenly becomes very, very hard. Because apparently like that difficulty, the idea of the building difficulty is not such a Chris Roberts thing. He's not such a traditional game designer in that way. He wants to do something spectacular that catches you early on. Same in Wing Commander 4. It's not a case where they relocated it, but the Maniac fight is one of the hardest fights in the game, and it's the first thing you do, and that's because they want to capture you with something different. So that's what happened with the Skipper. That's why it's there in Wing Commander 3 so early. But if the game were made today with the processes and outlines and everything we do today, it would have stayed in Series H, and you would have gotten the Skipper missile much, much later, and it would probably be much more people complaining about it, because suddenly the game would become weirdly difficult instead of making you think it was going to be that difficult at the start and then never getting there again. Dave asks if anybody has run into the Skipper in Wing Commander 3. I don't think I have, but I'm pretty sure I've run into the bioweapon missiles. And again, you can see Wing Commander 3 as designed is supposed to step you up. There's a series, the Locanda series, gives you missiles to shoot down, but they're not, they don't cloak. And then, so introducing a cloaked one later would have made sense, because it's making that gameplay loop harder. But that's not what happened. Instead, we get the Skipper missile first, and everything is easier after that. And of course, the other thing that really suffered from that decision, that gameplay decision, was Star Lancer, which kind of overdid the shooting down missiles thing. We just all take a moment to chuckle at the reference to Star Lancer, which really did do the shooting down torpedoes thing a lot. So here's all the lore for the Skipper missile, and what a tease at the end, where we have the cited for another threat report, CF threat report K422B Kilrathi stealth fighter, updated January 12, 2654. So that ties into something that Chris Roberts told Chris Reed and I when we were teenagers at the party after the Wing Commander movie, which was that he wanted to do Wing Commander 2 with the stealth fighters, you know, traitor storyline. And man, that would have been cool. I'm sure he knew it wasn't going to happen by that point already, but man, that would have been cool. And here is the slightest, tiny setup for it is the reference to the stealth fighter. But of course, you can, if you're building your continuity, you can take that and you can connect it to the stealth fighter from the Straka, that's actually a Sartha, that's radar reflective from Wing Commander Academy. You can connect it to the Super Wing Commander stuff, where Admiral Tallwin is insisting there's no stealth fighters and Colonel Halcyon is fighting with him. They add this runner and Super Wing Commander about that. So this is when the Kilrathi would be developing their stealth fighters. So Confederation Intelligence is exactly right. They're on Gorkar. They're starting to build them at this exact time. All right. That was the Skipper sequence. And now here is our last section of the night. How long? Oh, wow, we've been going for more than an hour. These are so long. This is our last one to look through tonight, and it is kind of a weird one. Again, if you are only familiar with the movie, you kind of wonder why this is here. This is the movie lore's reworked version of the Iacin encounter, which in Wing Commander 1, I think I brought it up in my browser so I can read. Wing Commander 1, the manual introduces the history of the Kilrathi War, as we all know, and the very first item is the discovery of the Kilrathi. I'll just read 25 years ago. That's 2629.105. Clawmark says that is March 15th. It's actually April 15th. I've never known what to make of that error because it's the first use of the Wing Commander Stardate system and it doesn't match correctly. But evolution and colonization ships of the Terran Confederation increased their penetration into the Vega sector. On 2629.105, March 15th, 2629, Terran Reckoning, the exploration ship Iacin encounters a spacecraft of unknown origin. Iacin Commander Jadora Andropoulos beams the standard wideband nonverbal greeting designed by the Committee for Interaction with Alien Intelligences. Captain Andropoulos keeps Iacin motionless for 22 minutes standard while the alien vessel waits. Finally, the alien vessel opens up with all guns, utterly destroying Iacin and all hands. That was our original story of how they met the Kilrathi. And like a lot of the early Kilrathi stuff, it is borrowed from whole cloth. It's essentially a kind of edited summary of the Larry Niven short story The Warriors from 1968, which is the origin of the Kzinti, was set in his then just growing known space universe, which is the story of a human ship, the Angel's Pencil, which encounters a mysterious alien ship. The aliens try to attack them. And then in the Larry Niven version, the Angel's Pencil figures out how to use their communication laser to kill the Zinti, and they win, but it's the start of their long series of wars. The Larry Niven aspect that is not in Wing Commander is that he had this whole setup for his known space stuff where there was this period in Earth's history where those damned libs had pacified Earth's population so much that they no longer appreciated weapons or violence. And there, the UN was this evil fascist society that had taken all the like things that true men love, like guns and weapons mostly. And humans had become pacified. And then the idea is they encounter the Zinti and they have to learn to fight war again. And they all become badasses because humans are badass killers deep down. Sure, why not? But Wing Commander stole the bones, if not the meaning, from that. The other one I'll point out, one of the only other references to Iacin in Wing Commander is the Victory Streak, which I've been looking at separately, has an article written by Guthrie Andropoulos, who's the grandson, or the son, I can't remember if it's son or grandson, I'll have to check, of Captain Jadora Andropoulos mentioned there. Who in that instance is a man. The Victory Streak makes it clear that Captain Andropoulos from the Iacin story is a man, and this one it's a lady, so we'll note that, I guess. So the movie, we talked about how it wanted to change stuff up. It instead gives us this story of the first encounter with the Kilrathi 20 years later in 9 years later than the original on 2638. And they edit the story a little bit so it's less literally the Angel's Pencil setup. Instead, it meets three Biru K-class merchantmen who they stand up for 5 hours. There's insane detail. One thing you're going to see if you go to the timeline I've been working on now is we basically have a minute-by-minute story of this Iacin encounter because there's this article and the one we'll see next week, which is where Paladin recalls his version of it. So we have this very detailed story about how they destroy the Iacin. They carry its hull to the Hyperion system. They dump it in orbit as a threat. The port admiral who's in charge of that system has it scanned. They find it's been all the bodies and the components have been removed. They dump it into a sun because they don't want to have the possibility of biological infection and so on. Now here on this page, we also get a little bit of a nod to, hey, maybe the game version also happened in the ship specification history. So we learned that it was commissioned in 2613, well before 2632, as a long-range exploration vessel. It spent X number of years as a long-range exploration vessel,
And then in 2633 was refitted to be a fleet support transport, and then refitted again in 2637 as an exploratory research vessel. The thing that if you really, really care about continuity and you want to tell a story that quote-unquote fixes this, you can stick right in there is that the reason it was refitted as a fleet support transport is because it was destroyed and they have the hull that they rebuilt. That's a fine story for me. Other aspects of it don't work so well, but that's enough for me to think about. I'll put both on the timeline and go from there. Because they're not super... This material doesn't super say this was the first encounter with the Carathi. It just is a very detailed, like, it encountered these. And it even gives the details in the report. This is the report made the same year, and it seems to know all about the Carathi. We get the specifications. That's so cool. That is so worth it to mix up this story a little bit, to get specifications for the Odysseus class. Hey, look, Odysseus, another kind of Greek Age of Exploration sort of reference. I guess it's the same as Ulysses. Oh, you know what? I have pictures of the A's in here. This is from the intro to the movie. This is the thing that plays in the background where we see the... One of the incidents in the movie intro is implied to be the Iasian incident, where there's a fighter called Sparrow that's inspecting some large unknown ship, and then it opens fire. And this is the ship. It seems to match the Sivar class from the movie. And ironically, it doesn't match the handbook at all. There's a single ship that's huge in the movie, whereas there's multiple ships in the book of the movie. So that's just one of those things. So... theoretically, that's a Biru K-class merchantman. Maybe they're multiple kilometers long because they have giant cargo holds or something. Giorgio says, that sounds a bit like Babylon 5 first kind of humans with Mimbari. Yes, and that is one that you can kind of laugh about all the time. I remember there was an old Farside cartoon where the natives of some primitive civilization don't understand why their greeting is... causing so much problems, and it's like strangling is how they say hello. The Babylon 5 story where the Mimbari show their respect by aiming their guns at you is a thought. So we have all this ice and stuff, and we continue to the next page with even more ice and stuff. We have the whole story of what was on board, what they were doing, and we have stuff like a Pelican-class shuttle, two Ferret-class scout fighters. There were ferrets on there. How interesting is that? There were ferrets. They're just telling us that there were ferrets in 2638 is interesting lore. Just excellent, like, background trash. It's got a 4.7 terajoule xenon-charged phase shield generator. Just great lore that you can take out of here and apply anywhere you want. I love the movie world stuff, like... Port of Hellespont. They have this whole sense, all ports are so important in the Wing Commander movie Confederation Handbook world, and you hear the names of them. Let's go on. Yeah, we've got a third page, and it just goes on and on. But the big question I think everybody has is, why is this here? Why is a movie that mentions the Iasian, not at all, really only in the sense of it's a thing that we saw go past in the intro, they don't name it or anything. Where did this come from? Why are we spending so much time? Why do we have two articles in this handbook that are talking so much about the Iasian? And you can pick up the very first part of it here, which is one of the ferrets is piloted by Commander Jay Taggart. That's Paladin. And we hear about how Commander Taggart remains in space outside while the ship is destroyed. His precise fate is unknown. This is because, and this is not such an exciting reveal. I feel like I've set up to be an exciting reveal, and it's not. This is all because Paladin, in the original cut of the movie, the shooting script, has a part where he talks about the Iasian, and that he was aboard it. And spoiler warning, I'm going to show you that part in just a minute, because AD has put it together in pretty good modern quality. He's re-edited the scene, so we'll watch that in a second. But originally the idea is that Blair, in the start of the movie, when he first sees Paladin on the bridge, notices his neck tattoo. And if you pause the movie, you can kind of see this blurry thing on Check Ikario's neck occasionally. It's a Kilrathi prison tattoo. Blair notices that. He tries to get a look at it. And then once they get to the Tiger's Claw, there's a scene that's unfortunately totally cut where he just outright asks Paladin, Why do you have that? And Paladin says, oh, you know what it is. Like, yeah, it's a Karathi prisoner of war tattoo. You were in a camp. And Paladin says, yeah, I was on the ice. And Maniac says, but there were no survivors. And Paladin goes, guess not. And then Maniac just looks shocked. And they're like, well, what do the Karathi look like? And he goes, ugly. And like, that absolutely should have been in the movie because, man, they look ugly. We'll look at that in just a second. Let me... I also have this, which is an inset from this book of the Iason logo. And again, it's that great, like, Greek mythology sense. I don't know how to say the name of the boat, so I'm not going to try. But it just gives a great sense. So, without further ado, I'm going to play the video that AD has made for us showing how the movie was originally going to involve the kind of a direct description of the Aizen. And because this was written and made before the movie was done, it was based on the shooting script. And they said, oh, we have to have all this explanation in the book of what Paladin meant. How was that part of his history? So we've got this. And then we have in the top secret part that we'll talk about later, we have Paladin's personal narrative of what he experienced and what it was like in a Karathi prison. And it's super cool. But let me show you a little video. It's 4 minutes long. I'll be right back.
Just put in beacon 147. It's a shortcut.
Hey, cut the circuit.
I come.
Steady on the beacon.
Marshall has a helm.
These must be antiques.
They were made by the first explorers in the sector. Pilgrims.
I couldn't help noticing the tattoo you have on your neck.
How about the pilgrim crest you hide under your vest? It's okay. We all have pasts and secrets.
It was my mother's.
May I see it? There was a time long ago when people looked up to the pilgrims.
The stars were their destiny.
Since the pilgrims were defeated, not a single new quasar has been charted. Stupid.
Main engine now at 90%.
Yeah, we won't, sir.
Captain, what about the tattoo?
You know what it is?
It's a Karathi marker. You were a prisoner of war.
That's right. I was on the Iason when they took me.
The Iason? That was the first ship to ever have contact with the Karathi.
Yeah, there weren't any survivors off the Iason.
Well, I guess not.
Why don't you have it removed?
Helps me not to forget.
Not to forget what?
Why I fight. Good luck.
Hey, what do the Karathi look like?
Ugly!
Ugly?
I knew they were ugly. Thanks.
There we go. There we go. Forget you just saw any of that. Should be working now. What happened was I somehow pressed the little button on my, I pressed it with my belly as I was talking, as we were between scenes. So I'm sorry about that. But I hope you were interested in that scene. No, surely you can hear me now. I see the little thing now. Okay, you got it. All right. So that scene was super interesting. It connects you with Paladin in a way that the finished movie doesn't. It connects Blair and Paladin. And you're probably left wondering, why was it cut out? It doesn't have anything to do with the traitor. It doesn't change anything about the movie other than add this character moment. And I believe the entire reason it was removed is because it goes linearly into the scene on the flight deck where they're walking along and Blair gets in the fighter and Angel calls him out. In the finished version of the movie, they swap things around. So the first thing you see them do on the Tiger's Claw is they're already on the bridge giving the orders to the captain, which makes sense. You know, you don't... That really should happen first. But as initially intended, it would have followed them from place to place to place. And you would have ended that scene with pointing out where Gerald was and then going to the bridge. So you couldn't have them... You couldn't have that scene at the very start with Paladin because it couldn't... You know, it would disrupt the flow of it. You would have to cut either that or the scene with the rapier. Both of them wouldn't work. Yeah, the ADR they do where they talk about hornets, which was done well after the fact. That was a line that was added for from a Wing Commander fan in Texas rather than anybody working on the ground at Luxembourg. The original line was that he doesn't see the XO anywhere because they're looking for Gerald. So dropping that idea that they're looking for Gerald and then have that scene, you can't really have the scene with Paladin as good as it is. So that is why there is so much focus on the Aizen. Yeah, Lee has his maniac thing. Blonde is a totally different infection. I remember Chris McCubbin being so excited to point out that that was supposed to be a call-out to Ginger Lynn's character in Wing Commander 3. I don't know if that's intentional or not, but they thought so. So that is why we hear so much about the Aizen. The Aizen's, and you hear they say Aizen. By the way, I looked this up on those like how to pronounce websites, and all the ways we're saying it were Lair and others. So I still don't know what the right answer is, but I'm gonna try and copy Paladin because he's so cool. Let's see. Yeah, Trelane is right. Nobody ever pushes the mute button on their thing on purpose. But Leha had pointed out that Chikikari was such a good pick for Paladin. He absolutely is, and Chris Roberts knew it. His salary was the highest on the film. It was just shy of $1 million, which is way more than anybody else. They wanted Chikikario as Paladin, and it works. But we all hated it at the time. Wing Commander fans were so angry that he wasn't Scottish. AD says the Paladin scene is important in the cut with the traitor subplot because it's key to his Lair's personal identity struggle. I personally think that it works to help obscure the Kilrathi. Like, introducing the idea that people don't really know what the Kilrathi looks like is a pretty good excuse to not really show the Kilrathi much. But that's just me. So all this Aizen lore, it's already in the timeline. Let's look at a preview of what we're going to see next week, or in a couple days when I do this again. We've got a psychological profile of Lieutenant Christopher Blair, which is going to be interesting because how long has Kelvin been spying on Blair and why? Could it be connected to the events of Wing Commander 4? Maybe. We have a long, long detailed history of Pilgrim powers, which I kind of want to do as like a history class where we walk through the development of Pilgrim powers ourselves. We'll figure out some interesting thing to do. We've got the Navcom AI and how it works. And then finally we've got the inquiry on Paladin. And last but not least, the correspondence from Taggart to Tolwyn. Letter he's writing him. Basically, he's just gotten the orders that he's going to take Blair and Maniac to the Tiger's Claw. And he's writing to Tolwyn about what his other secret mission is and so on. And it's super interesting gloss for the world of the movie. We'll see all that next time. AD says Maniac is telling him to get rid of the cross constantly, so Blair is wondering about Paladin's connection to something bad from his past. Which, yeah, that's good writing, insofar as such things go. So that is it for the Confederation Handbook secret section. We'll be doing a top secret live stream next. And then after that, we'll do some more interesting stuff. Maybe we'll even play a game at some point. But I hope you're all enjoying this stuff. If anybody has any questions, let me know right now, or we'll close this thing out, and I'll go hang out with my wife for a while and talk to you guys on Discord about more Wing Commander stuff. I'm gonna check Discord now. Somebody had added me. Oh, it was Jason, and he was adding me about Babylon 5. So something about Babylon 5 to read after this stream. By the way, how much fun was Comic-Con this year? I didn't go, but it just seemed like it was such a much more interesting thing without the giant studios around. And it was such a treasure to get the Star Trek Strange New Worlds episode that aired as a surprise on Saturday or Sunday. That was exactly what we needed, that escape from the world, and it was such a great episode. So, yeah, watch Star Trek. That's my takeaway here. Thanks for writing in. Thanks for hanging out with me. We'll do it again real soon. And we'll do other stuff. And it'll be fun. All right. I appreciate the kind words, everybody. Thank you.